I think I'd like to start tonight with giving you a glossary that we'll be working with as we go through this study. And this glossary is sort of words that we're going to be looking at that are keys to interpretation of the stories that we will encounter. And it comes from the Kabbalistic or apocryphal system of revealing things through symbols. And we'll find them fairly consistent throughout our study. The first one that we want to deal with is woman. Wherever we find a story of a woman in the Bible, we can always replace this woman with a symbol. She is the symbol of the soul of man. So every time you encounter a story of a woman, think of her as your soul, and in fact she is a particular being. She is the divine lover of God. So whatever she's doing, she is doing in her role as God's estranged lover. And if she is then a virgin, she is without alternate lovers. She is, in other words, not an adulteress. So you find these stories over and over and over of the adulteress, the virgin, or the woman who is the lover of God. And she is usually playing one of these roles, the virgin or the adulteress, and that gives us the key to whether she is prepared to be God's lover in right relationship, or whether she is estranged from him at the moment. Now, women also appear in a couple of other roles as sister and as mother. The sister of a man, fairly consistently throughout Scripture, is his feminine side, or his intuitive side, his listening side of his consciousness, as opposed to the active side. The man is the active counterpart of the soul. One thing that you'll find in studying Scripture is that it doesn't work to think of the characters as men or women in a sexist sense, because every man in the Bible is the male part of every woman living today. And every woman in the Bible is the female part of every man living today. So if you think that the Bible is extremely sexist, you are misreading it. It appears to be on the surface because the man is always the active principle. But this is because they are conveying an idea of energy. They are talking about active and passive principles. They're not talking about men and women, and that's where all the confusion comes from, and whether we should ordain women, whether they should be women priests, and so on. It's this phenomenal misunderstanding of the fact that the Bible is written about the active principle in mankind, which is both men and women, and the feminine principle in mankind. And the feminine always plays the role of the listening, and when a woman in the Bible gets into an active role, she gets in trouble, because it is the symbol of a person misusing the passive side of their nature. And a man playing the woman's role gets in trouble for the same reason. And that's what it's attempting to convey. So we need to think of all of these in terms of dream symbols. A woman in a dream is the female side of myself. A man in the dream is the male side of myself. And both men and women need to read it in the same way. Keep in mind that when you were born, you may not like this. When you were born, there were two cells that you were made out of, right? One of those cells was male and one was female. All of you. You were not conceived male or female. You were half and half. You were just as female as you were male when you were born, and you were just as male as you were female. And a little bit later, you formed a body to form a particular function. But you started out half and half. So whether you like it or not, fellows, you're half woman. That's the way you started. And that female side of yourself is just as important as the male side of yourself to be developed and to function in wholeness and completion. And so it is with women. And so these roles that are spoken of in the Bible are the roles that we play with the sides of ourself and have nothing to do with whether the character historically was biologically male or female. It is the principle that they were putting to work that is being spoken of. The female principle is the ability in every person. The reason I call it the soul, it's not literally the soul, so I probably should say it this way. The woman is the ability that each of us has to have a womb which God can impregnate with His presence so that we give birth to His expression through us. So it is that part of me that can be the mother of God's child as a man that is the woman in the Bible. And it is that part of a woman that can put to work her intuition, can get out and do something. It's that the Bible speaks of when it speaks of a man. That is the priest, the other is the priestess. So the things that were done by the men in the Bible can be done by either men or women. Any woman can be a priest as easily as a man if she uses the masculine principle in her and keeps the feminine principle developed as well. The person who makes the mistake is the one who loves one and hates the other, and so subdues one and emphasizes the other, becomes an imbalanced individual. So the sister of a man is his intuitive nature. The mother is that which gave birth to the masculine principle that is being talked about. So it's where he came from. It's the activity, the idea, the thought that he came from, the consciousness that he came from is described as his mother. And this will gain in importance as we go through the stories. We'll see how that is used from time to time. So the virgin and the adulteress are the important roles played by the women, also the mother and sister, usually less important roles. Then there's the shepherd. Wherever we find the shepherd, we want to read that as the meditator or the person who is taking responsibility for his thoughts. A shepherd is a person who is shepherding his thoughts. And the reason for using this particular word in the way that the Kabbalist used it was that sheep are animals that follow one another. If one starts out going a direction, all the rest will line up and follow it. Your thoughts do the same thing. If you get a fear thought in your mind, then all your thoughts line up behind it and they start multiplying and going down that fear trail. Unless you're a person who's taken responsibility for your thoughts, then you herd them and you take them in the direction that you want them to go to be fed. That's a shepherd, a person who herds his flock of thoughts and directs them into the right direction. The shepherd also, traditionally in the stories you will find, gives the first fruits of his flock to God, which means he gives his first thoughts to God. As opposed to the man of the earth in some other kind of occupation who, when he gives a gift to God, gives a gift of the earth. He gives his substance, his material things. God is not particularly interested in that, at least not unless the first fruits of the thoughts are also given. So the shepherd is one who is guiding his thoughts and giving the first, or the most important, the direction of his thoughts to God. I wonder if we can move some of this apparatus so I don't have quite such an obstacle course here. Maybe we can just set this back here. I'm afraid I'm going to turn over some water or stumble over a cord in a minute. Do I have more cord? Good. Thank you. The next we want to look at is the temple builder. This is a really interesting one, and we'll deal with it in a little bit. Two particular instances that are important. The temple builder is an initiate. Now that means a temple builder is a man who has educated himself in universal principles, universal law. He knows what to expect from the universe. He knows how to cooperate with universal law. He knows how to set universal law in motion. We could, in fact, say that he's an occultist. He understands principles that are hidden to other people, not hidden from them, but they are hidden to them only because they have not educated themselves in that understanding. Maybe a couple of examples to show you why they picked this particular word to mean an initiate. In ancient Egypt and ancient Chaldea, which were two of the most influential countries in the development of Israel, there were magnificent structures that were built long before Abraham came along. We're talking about prehistory now. These magnificent structures were built in particular ways. In order to build a temple, one had to know geometry. This is an interesting problem in that, according to our historians, geometry wasn't discovered yet. But you had to know geometry in order to build these magnificent temples. You had to know a lot of other things that were considered magic among the populace because they simply didn't know the secrets of how to fit these stones together, and particularly what stone to put together in what order, because these temples were built in interesting ways. There's a temple called the Ziggurat that is found in Chaldea. The Ziggurat is built in seven levels, seven platforms, one on top of the other, and each platform is smaller than the one below it, so that the effect is like a pyramid, a seven-terraced pyramid. And each of these platforms has a runway that goes up to the next higher platform, so that you have, in effect, a spiral that goes up to the top of the pyramid. Each of these levels, each platform, was dedicated to one of the planets, one of the heavenly bodies of the time, including the sun and the moon. In Chaldea, the lower platform, the lowest and largest platform, was dedicated to the sun. The uppermost platform was dedicated to the moon. Each of the platforms in between was dedicated to one of the planets, but the sun and the moon were considered the most important. Now, when the temple was built, it was the responsibility of the temple builder to observe the position of the sun and the moon in relation to those other planets, and to use sizes and shapes of stones and quality of stone and color of stone that would indicate the significance of those relationships. For example, if Mars and Venus were in detrimental aspect to one another, then a dark stone was used to indicate the relationship of the planet Mars, the platform that represented Mars, to the platform that represented Venus. And then if you were an initiate, if you knew how to read the stones, you could walk up that platform around the spiral going to the top of the ziggurat, and you could read the horoscope of the world on your way up the platform, because all of the astrological relationships were written into the size, quality, shape, and color of the stones that were used to make the platform. Now, in order to build such a temple, the builder had to be an astrologer, an extraordinary astrologer. He had to be a geometer, and he had to know the quality of the stones. He had to be an artisan, a craftsman. He had to know things that the public didn't know. And by knowing astrology, he was considered a wise man. By being a wise man, he was one of the most important people in the kingdom. There were only a few, just a handful. They were all advisors to the royalty, and they were considered as important and as powerful as the king. So when we speak of a temple builder in the Bible, we're speaking of one of these people who had that kind of information. There are two of them that are outstanding in our study in Scripture. One is a man named Terah, who we'll be talking about tonight. The other is Solomon and Hiram Abiff, who built the temple in Jerusalem. So when we talk about building a temple, we're talking about an initiate. And by the way, the temple that they built was a life, not a physical structure. The temple builder attempted to build a state of consciousness, And he either built a state of consciousness that was his personal life, or he built a state of a consciousness in a nation. So that when Solomon built the temple in Israel, the importance was not that he erect a structure, a physical structure, but that he lift the consciousness of the nation to a particular level. And when you go into all of the particulars about the building of that temple, you are reading a story of an initiate among a nation of people trying to lift the consciousness of that nation to a particular level. Doing it in stone is only a reflection of what he was trying to do in consciousness. And if it was not done in consciousness, the stonework had no meaning and did not exist as a temple in reality. So this is the purpose of the temple builder. You're going to find kings. And there are two kinds of kings. We'll call them kings of the earth. And kings of heaven, or kings by divine right. The difference in these is one who is a ruler over the affairs of earth and is not in turn ruled by God, and the other is one who is ruled by God and passes on that rulership to the earth. And what he really is, the king of heaven, is one who is a priest. He is, again, a temple builder, but of a different sort. He is not necessarily an initiate, but he is one who is following divine guidance. So you could say that he is, in a sense, a little less than the initiate, and you'll find that he is also always a warrior. And of all of the things that you might not think of as a spiritual person, a warrior seems the less likely. A person who is going out into battle and killing people does not sound like a person that would be a spiritual leader, until you understand what a warrior is and who his enemies were. The most famous of these, of course, is King David. And the stories that we find in the Psalms, the prayers that he prayed, are one of the most interesting studies of King David, and in fact, it can get disturbing for people who don't know the keys to interpretation of Scripture. You get into reading these Psalms that are supposed to be beautiful hymns of praise to God, and you find them full of phrases like, trample my enemies under my feet, break their heads and let them bleed, and all of these gory things about killing all of these enemies that are hiding behind all of the rocks, and you get a little disgusted with these sacred hymns that are talking about all this killing of people. How can that be so spiritual? It's not until you understand that the warrior is you, and the enemy are those things that keep you from manifesting your highest good. If you are a determined student of spiritual growth, you are a warrior. And you have enemies. Most of those enemies are inside you. They are attitudes, emotions, beliefs, programmed thinking. It is that you're trying to kill. It is that enemy that you're trying to crush under your heel. That's the warrior. And the warrior king, then, is one who has overcome his enemies. Can you imagine a better king? Don't you wish we had one like that ruling the United States? One who has overcome his victim consciousness, his emotions, his greed, his ambition. He has overcome his enemies. He's put them under his feet. And by virtue of overcoming the enemies, he becomes a ruler. A ruler that leads people into a place of peace. When we speak of heaven, we're not talking about another place out there in another dimension. That's another thing that we need to be aware of in Scripture. There is never a place in all of the Bible where there is a reference to a place out there in space somewhere beyond the clouds that is a kingdom of heaven that we are going to when we leave here. That story is not in the Bible, even though you all probably grew up with it. I mean, earth is here and hell is under. How can hell get under this ball? If it's under to the Chinese, it's up here, right? I bet you suspected that. We're living in Chinese hell. So there's this idea that there is earth and hell is down there and heaven is up here. But all of these are states of consciousness. Hell is a perpetual state of being consumed by your own mistakes, failures, emotions. If those things do consume you, that's where you live, in that consciousness. Earth is that place where we meet the challenges of daily life. Heaven is that state of consciousness in which our earth is ruled by the King of Heaven. And if the King of Heaven is ruling our earth, then heaven and earth are the same place, the same experience, in the same time we live in heaven on earth. So heaven, when we read of it in the scripture, is a state of consciousness, and the King of Heaven is a warrior who has overcome his enemies in earth and is able to lead people with him into a state of consciousness or a state of peace. Sons in all the stories are the consciousness that I give birth to, the child that results from the way that I live my life. And again, perhaps a good example of this is that David, by being a warrior and overcoming the enemies on earth, finally entered a place that is the kingdom of heaven, and he gives a birth to a son whose name essentially means the child of the son, the other son. And this child of his rules a kingdom of peace. There was never a battle during the reign of his son Solomon. But David gave birth to the consciousness that ruled Israel. So the father was a warrior king who overcame his enemies, and the son that resulted from that was an initiate who took us a step further into building a life that is the kingdom of heaven, building the temple and creating a place where God lives with us and among us, where we can have direct communication. In fact, during David's reign as a warrior king, there was what was called a tabernacle, a tent in which they worshiped God, and it moved around. It was not a stationary thing. But his son, the consciousness that he gave birth to, created a permanent home for God in his midst. So we're speaking of two different qualities of beings in spiritual growth. There is the warrior who is fighting and overcoming his enemies. When he ceases to be a warrior, he gives birth to his child, and his child then is a king of peace, or a prince of peace. The prince of peace creates a permanent place in which God lives in him. The warrior is the one who has communication with God. You're probably familiar with these two steps. The warrior is the one who is in touch with God. He meditates, but he meditates in the morning and at night. And in between, he's out there battling with the enemies of the earth. But when he grows enough, he's no longer meditating morning and night, but he is in constant communication with God round the clock. And his meditation never stops. He prays without ceasing. He has given a permanent temple to God in his life. Now he is the Prince of Peace, not the warrior king. So it's a graduation from one level to another level, from David to Solomon. So as you begin to see these words and read them in that way, you begin to see these people as examples of different levels of spiritual growth, and the entire Bible becomes a textbook telling you what spiritual growth is like and what the trials are that you run into on the spiritual path. And that's what it should become. It is a manual for apprentice gods. Let's see. We're going to run into numbers, which are going to be very significant all the way through, and we should know. We should know about the Hebrew system of numerology, which was called Gematria. Can you see that? Is that right, as well as the black? Gematria is Hebrew numerology, and there's a very basic and important difference between Hebrew numerology and numerology done with the English language. The the most basic problem with using numerology with the English language is that the English letters, the English alphabet, is not numerologically based, meaning that the letters do not have an inherent numerical significance. So to assign them a numerical value is to assign it arbitrarily, and it does not have the significance that a language that is numerically based will have numerologically. So it is arbitrary, it is not not as effective, let's say. Every letter in the Hebrew alphabet was also a number, and obviously you could read any word as a numerical value. And so they did that. Very often they would use a word of a numerical value to replace another word of the same numerical value, which did not have the same meaning at all, except the numerical value. They would take that one word, replace it with another word, just to create a code. And only those who knew gematria would be able to make sense out of the text, because they had simply lifted a word and inserted a word that had a completely different meaning but the same numerical value. And so a person who realizes that gematria was being used there could look at that word and say, that doesn't make sense. Now supposing I look up all the other words that have the same numerical value and try them, and I try and I find the word that they have replaced in the text, and as I go through replacing all of these words, then I make sense out of the text. This is done frequently throughout the Bible, much to the consternation of those who don't know gematria. And it's done particularly in the book of the Revelation, and it's where the mark of the beast comes from, the number 666, also where the 144,000 come from. And because these are read as numbers in our Bible, they don't make sense. And people wind up thinking that there are only going to be 144,000 people in heaven. And it doesn't mean that at all. It does mean that people who reach a particular state of consciousness will get to heaven. And that state of consciousness is the state of the initiate being initiated into the kingdom. So the word that was replaced there is the word initiate. And it has the same numerical value as the numbers that were put there. So we have to replace the numbers with the letter. In gematria, the number one, which is the letter Aleph, stands for the single-mindedness, one individual, the one, in a conversation, even now, in the state of Israel. If you hear a person say, the one has decided this, you know who he's talking about, don't you? He's talking about God, the one God. And he will say, the one has decided this, because he doesn't use the word God except in prayer, because it's a reverent word. So this word, this number, one, is first cause or first principle or God. It is undivided and indivisible. It also sometimes means the initiate, but not usually. Instead, the number 10 means the initiate. And the reason here is because now you have one walking with infinity, zero being infinity. So 10 is the number of the initiate, one is the number of God. Two is a number that signifies duality. Something is split, it has polarity, it has two sides, it is beside itself. And all of these numbers will have both a negative connotation and a positive connotation. The negative connotation of one being aloneness, being separated or apart or alone. The negative connotation of two is separation from God, being split into two halves, not being whole or together. The number three is the number of the Trinity, either the heavenly Trinity or the earthly Trinity. The earthly Trinity being mind, body, and spirit, heavenly Trinity being Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, or Father, Mother, Child, God. In Kabbalah, the three upper Sephiroth and the three lower Sephiroth, the Sephiroth of Earth and the Sephiroth of Heaven. Now, if you're not familiar with Kabbalah yet, just wait, we'll get to that next week. But you'll see the significance of the number three there. Three is used as indicating something about one or the other of these trinities. The number four is four square. It refers to the elements. It refers to the steps in creation. Here we have the steps of creation. We have a point in space, non-dimensional. We have a line. We have a plane, and we have a solid. So these are the steps in creation. And according to the Hebrew myths, the earth was created by using the Hebrew alphabet. And the Hebrew alphabet says, from a point there came a line, and there formed a plane, and then there was solid. And this story of creation unfolds just in reading through the Hebrew alphabet. Each number takes you another step. The next number then being five, once you have a solid, the next thing that you put with it is senses. Five senses indicate life or consciousness. So five is adventure, sensuality, usually used in its negative sense of sensuality when we find that number appearing. And the number six then is two trinities, the heavenly trinity and the earthly trinity, either in balance or not in balance. In the number 666, for example, it is not in balance. The three are separated from one another. So 666 says that the heavenly trinity and the earthly trinity have not come together into one. So the number six is a relationship between the two trinities looking for balance. The number seven is the completion of all of the steps to bring a life form that can relate to God. Number seven is the opening of the highest consciousness, the crown chakra, the completion of a spiritual exercise, the completion of a phase of evolution. We're speaking here of the 7 days of creation, or the seven chakras in man, the seven planes of heaven, the seven steps in opening to God consciousness. The number eight is two fours. And again, we have a struggle for balance with matter. For this reason, the number eight is very often related to material wealth or money, trying to get financial things into balance. Balance with material, four square matter. The number nine, its significance is primarily that it is one before 10, which means two things. In a positive sense, it means a pre-initiate. A warrior who is working hard to become an initiate is a number nine. But so is a person who has no interest in becoming an initiate. He is a number nine. Now, how do you know if it is a positive or a negative application of the number nine? If it is a positive application of the number nine, it will appear with zeros. For example, 144,000 is getting a material balance together while walking with the one and lifting your consciousness to infinity. You are a number nine who is attempting to become a 10, stepping into the kingdom, becoming complete and whole. If it's a 666, then your spiritual and your physical trinities are separated from one another, not in communication with one another, and you are ruled by the sensuality of your body. But this is also a number nine. Both of them are a number nine. But one is a positive, the other is a negative. You're frowning at that.
Yeah, I couldn't step in 666 as a negative.
Okay.
I didn't get it before.
All right, if this 666 were 1,000, then it would be added with infinity, and it would be one who is attempting to bring these together, to blend them together. Heavenly Trinity, earthly Trinity are separated beside one another instead of being brought together as one number, as you've done here.
Okay, take it back to the original six. You said the six was the heaven and the earth coming together, but when you added two more...
Okay. The six is talking about the two Trinities, Heavenly Trinity and Earthly Trinity. If it is standing alone, then they are together. They are one number. But if you put them beside each other, it says Heavenly Trinity, Earthly Trinity, Heavenly Trinity, Earthly Trinity, Heavenly Trinity, Earthly Trinity, separated into three, have not come together as one. They have not balanced, have not blended. They're standing beside each other. So they're using the number that means both of these, but they are separating the number three times to say the three of them are not communicating with one another. And because he is separated from himself into three parts, he is ruled by his physical part. So he is ruled by his beast, his body with its senses, and it tells him whether he can go in or out, whether he can buy or sell, whether he can live or die. It's dictator over his life. And this number is stamped on his forehead, which means that his sight has not opened, his third eye has not opened so that he can see. So he is ruled by the self of the senses and bears the mark of the beast. Okay? The number 10, as we said before, is then one walking with infinity. The number 11 is also one walking with God. And there's a really interesting commentary on the difference between these two numbers. This is an initiate, and this is an initiate. But you'll find as you read about Abraham, Noah, and Enoch, these are three initiates of the Old Testament. When it speaks of Abraham, it says he was a righteous man. He walked before God. When you read of Noah, it says he was a righteous man who followed after God. When you read about Enoch, you read about a righteous man who walked with God and was not, meaning that he was caught up into his presence and was no longer separated from him. So the difference here is one walking with infinity, one standing beside infinity. There's only a subtle difference. Walking before God means that you get ahead of him sometimes. You brashly, boldly go in and do things for him that he would just as soon you hadn't. And walking after him means that that you take a little longer than you might ought have to get to where he wants you to go. You're still righteous in both cases, but walking with him, side by side with him, you are acting as he acts, not following after him or walking before him, but acting with him, you are harmonious with all that he is doing. So that's a number 11 initiate. Number 12, is the number of the powers in man, the number of your assets, your abilities, the lessons of life. It is most frequently applied to the 12 colleges in the university of life. And this takes us directly into astrology. And by the way, it's very difficult to read the Bible without knowing something of astrology because it's full of it from cover to cover. It is an astrologically based book, and of course it would have to be because astrology is our universe, isn't it? And the Bible is about the universe and the working of it, and astrology is about the universe and the working of it, and the relationships between the bodies that are placed there. Their interrelationships are read about in astrology and then commented upon in the Bible. So there's a very direct relationship between the two disciplines. There is, in my opinion, a great shame that astrologers study astrology and throw away the Bible and Bible scholars study the Bible and throw away astrology. When the two of them get their heads together, they will understand for the first time their own discipline. Astrology is best understood by reading the commentary about it in its application throughout the Bible. The Bible is best understood from an astrological background. When you marry the two, they both become significant and have greater meaning. So you have these stories of the 12 colleges of life and the 12 challenges of life, and some examples there are the 12 apostles representing 12 personality types or 12 character types, each with their own challenges, and the 12 tribes of Israel, the 12 sons of Jacob, each again commenting on those challenges. But the most interesting perhaps is the Queen of Heaven, who occurs in Revelation. The completed woman, this soul that we were talking about before, the divine lover, is shown in three ways in the Bible. She is shown as the rebellious woman, the woman leaving her lover and going out into the world. She is called Eve. And then she is shown as the woman in chains, and there she is Rahab the harlot or Mary Magdalene. And then she is shown as the virgin who gives birth to the child of God, his lover. And following that, she's shown one more time. And in this particular case, she is described as wrapped in a robe of light with her feet standing on the earth and 12 stars above her head. Each of those stars being graduation from one of the 12 colleges of life. She has overcome one of those constellations, and the stars, instead of being her challenges, are now the jewels in the crown that she wears, and her authority for being the bride of God in the heavenly marriage. So this is the 12. The 13 is the 12 being guided by the heavenly Trinity, or the 12 with their teacher initiate. The 13 is the number of the apostles with the Christ, which is whole. Without the Christ, they are not whole. They are 12 powers without guidance. The 13 is with the guidance. And of course, this 13 solidifies its action, where the 12 does not. Only those 12 numbers are of particular significance to us. There are other numbers that were sacred in Gematria, and in fact, multiples of those numbers become important. But you can find the meaning of the multiples of those numbers by putting these together. Just a couple of other things that I think that we ought to add to our glossary. Our house, a house being a container in which we live, which might be the physical body, or it might be the structure that we are building by the way that we live our life, which is most frequent. It is not usually the physical body, but it is usually the structure that we are building by our activity in life. It is our temple. It is where we live. So the stories of building a house or the location of a house and so on in the stories, talking about the way that we are building our life, the structure in which we live. Animals generally refer to the animal nature. The responsibility of man for the living things around us, and maybe for the control of a part of the sensual nature within us. High place or mountain is very important in some of the stories. Wherever you read of a person going up into a high place, they are going to a higher state of consciousness to communicate with God. This is a tower, a pinnacle of a temple, a mountain, or simply a high place. A desert place is a place of emptiness. And in fact, you're going to find this interesting, I think, in the stories. Usually, just before a major spiritual breakthrough, we find our hero in a desert place. The desert is the place in which he gave up his opinions. Usually, just before he was in a desert place, he was in a wilderness or in a valley. And the two have different meanings. What do you suppose a wilderness is?
Confusion.
Wilderness is confusion. A valley?
Depression,
low place. A disappointment, being in the valley. We still use all those symbols. A high place in consciousness, a mountaintop experience we refer to. A sea or a river or a lake, all of these are places of life-giving sustenance that are emotional, spiritual, and they are cleansing. So there are a couple of instances here, I think, that we can use to illustrate this. When Jesus began his ministry, he went through the wilderness to a desert place. There he fasted. He fasted to empty himself of all thoughts and ideas of earth. Keep in mind that something about a fast that may never have occurred to you. If any of you have ever fasted, you probably did without food for a period of time. Maybe you took some juices or some water, but it might not have occurred to you that there is a word fast or a thought fast that is as important as your food fast, which says, if you are doing without food, but you are feeding upon emotions and thoughts that are still your beliefs, you're not fasting. The mind isn't fasting. It's still feeding on the same thing that was building your problems in the first place. The mind has to fast as well to empty it of the toxins that get into the mind. Fasting needs to be done on all levels in order to be a genuine purification experience. So he fasted for 40 days and 40 nights. Now that we've just gone through these numbers, we're going to run into this 40-day period over and over again. In fact, sometimes it will be 40 years instead of 40 days. What do you suppose this 40 is? Let's take the four. What was the meaning of our four? Material things, matter. And we've added to it infinity, a symbol for God. Now, what have we done with matter in 40 days? Spiritualized it. That's a good way of saying it, I think. We have formed a different relationship with matter. We have overcome it. It is no longer our boss. Now, think of this. If physical pain can determine the way you feel, whether you feel good or not, whether you can carry on your work or not, then you are bound to matter. It's ruling over you. If the things that you own can make you so anxious that you can't get on with your work, how many times have you heard, I'd really like to do that, I'd really like to serve in that way, but I have to make a living. Or I have to look after the dogs and cats. I have a family at home. Matter is ruling. A 40-day period or a 40-year period is the period that it takes us to make the ruler of our life change from matter or material to spiritual things. That's what happened to Israel in the wilderness. They spent 40 years in the wilderness because what happened? What was the decision that made them stay in the wilderness? They were afraid that on a material level, they were not strong enough to overcome the tribes that lived in Canaan. Purely material thought. The thing that appealed to them about Canaan was the material wealth that it had. The size of the grapes, land flowing with milk and honey. There are two problems there. One is they were attracted to material wealth, whereas their reason for entering into Canaan should have been that it was God's guidance. That's where God told them to go. So whether it had material wealth or not should not have been the decision about whether they went or not, but that's what it was based on. Two, they were afraid materially, we cannot overcome them. Those guys are like giants. We are like grasshoppers in their sight. The question should have been, can God overcome them? So on both of those points, matter ruled over them and God did not. But it took another generation. It took this 40 years, this period of overcoming matter. Now, whether that was literally 40 years or not, I'm not particularly concerned about. I know that that's not what the story means. That's not what the writer meant using gematria. He is telling me they stayed in the wilderness long enough to overcome their victimization by matter, long enough to overcome being ruled by matter. Now, however long that was, it may have been 200 years, but it was 40 years to the gematria writer. So 40 days and nights in the desert, the ark 40 days and nights on the water, all of these are talking about the same thing, the period of overcoming the limitations of matter. Let's see, we have animals, high place, desert, wilderness, valley. Spring, lake, river, ocean, we've talked about all of those, and they are all life-giving places. A well is another one. A well is going into the depths of myself, to the point where life comes from. The waters of life spring up from the depths of the well in me. So this is what I want to look at. When a person goes to a well, he is going to the deepest point in himself to find the source of life with him and bring it to the top, which is, of course, a description of a Kundalini experience. This water was used for washing, cleansing, baptism. Baptism, by the way, did not begin with Jesus Christ or the apostles. It was a Jewish cleansing ritual much before that, called the mikveh, and it was an immersion in water that did two things. It was cleansing experience, but more important, I'm immersing myself in the symbol of cleansing and spirit. Water is the movement of spirit over the earth, and the movement of water over the earth impregnates it and allows it to bring life. When I immerse myself in that, I have gone into the womb of life, and I emerge a new creature. So it is a symbol of regeneration. And it was used for healing. It was used for spiritual cleansing ritual. It was used for ending one period and starting a new period. It is an initiation rite. So we're going to make that our glossary for now. And so as we go into the stories now, we'll read the stories from that point of view, and I think they'll take on a different significance with that glossary. We're going to go back into Genesis now and see if we can go straight through the stories that are there, perhaps as quickly as we can. But I'd like to give you a little background before we do that. There is a book at the beginning of the Bible, Genesis, that contains the basic instruction for building a spiritual life. There's a book in the center of the Bible that synopsizes the whole story of spiritual growth, and then there's a book at the end that talks about the result of that. So we're talking about Genesis, the Song of Songs, and Revelation. And we're talking about the beginning of a story, the middle of the story, and the ending of the story. And I call it the only story that is in the Bible. And I call it that because I believe that it is. There's only one story there. And everything else is a variation on a theme. If you've ever listened to a symphony, you probably realize that in the early part of the symphony, you'll pick out a little note phrase that is the statement of a theme. And then that theme will go into variations and movements and repeat itself over and over and over throughout the symphony in different ways. But you'll find that that's the key. And usually it's just one little short phrase, a few little simple notes, but that's what gives character to the whole thing. So it is with the Bible. There's a theme, and that's the only story there is. And all the other stories are attempts to show the different sides and shadings of meaning to this only story. And the only story, I would begin this way. It says, in the beginning, there was a creative being whose very character, nature, even his name, was love. He was so completely the expression of love that it is what the expression of him is. It's what he gives birth to. It is it's his identity. It's his nature. It expresses all that he is. And he had this abundance of love to give. And this being was so complete that he had absolutely no needs. It couldn't be a need for such a complete, all-powerful, creative being as this original divine lover, except one. There was one need, and that one need was for an object for his love, somebody to love. He had this love to give, and no one to express it on. And so he decided to create a being who could share this love with him. And to create this being, he reached inside himself. Not an externally created being, but he took part of his own nature, and the part of his nature that he selected to take to make his bride was a particular part of himself. Love is identified with the heart. And so he took a place from the bottom of his heart, from beneath his rib, the tenderest, most delicate, and most vulnerable part of himself. And from beneath his own rib, he took this tender, vulnerable part, and he fashioned for himself a lover, a bride. And of course, because she would be his bride, the mother of his children, he made her beautiful. She was spectacularly beautiful and appealing to him, and he immediately fell deeply in love with her and was very pleased with what he had created, very pleased to be with her. And as they shared time together, it was a pleasant experience. She returned his love, as far as she knew. I mean, the fact was, he had chosen her. He had made her. He loved her by choice. But her love for him was sort of by virtue of the fact that there wasn't anyone else to love. Not that he wasn't loving and lovely. I mean, in fact, this being, this divine lover, was so confident that he just knew that if she had all the choices in the world, she'd still choose me. That was his feeling about it. And he was so confident of that, that he seems to have felt that has to be true in order for our love to be complete. That has to be true to the extent that I must give her all of the alternatives in the world, and if she will choose them, then she chooses them. And if she does choose them, then she doesn't really love me. She doesn't have the quality of love for me that I have for her. But I have confidence that she will choose me. And so I will create for her alternatives so that she will have that choice, so that she will have the opportunity to choose me rather than the alternate lovers. Now, when he chose the alternate lovers, when he created them, he could have created alternate lovers that had absolutely no appeal. And then, of course, she would have chosen him. But that also wouldn't have been fair, and it wasn't his nature. So he created alternative lovers for her, and he made each of them extremely appealing, and each for a different reason. But he also created for her at the same time a gift of love to express his love for her. He created a dazzling universe, spangled with moons and stars, planets, living things, beauty, wonder, creativity. He created a spectacular wedding gift, and he gave it to her. And she was fascinated with it. She loved it. She touched it and toyed with it. She wandered into it to see how it would work. And she enjoyed it, and he was delighted. He wanted her to enjoy it. And he followed after her as she went into it and explored it and was dazzled by it. And he followed after her saying, "Do you really like it? Do you really enjoy it?" And she didn't answer. She was too fascinated. She was getting into it and discovering the awe of it. And he followed her further and said, "Do you really like it? Are you really pleased?" He could see that she was. But finally she said, "Go away. I'm busy. I'm enjoying this." And so he did go away. But he went away to get the wedding feast ready, thinking, "She'll be right back. Won't be long." But while she was toying with this new discovery, she ran into the first of the alternate lovers. The first one was sensuality. She began to discover the appetites and how it feels to fulfill the appetites. And she made love to him, and she had his children. And she experienced the pleasures of sensuality. And she found that pleasure is addictive. If I look to pleasure for happiness, then I have to have more pleasure and more pleasure. I have to keep it going. And I find myself chained to pleasure, and he's ruling over me. And whenever he's not there making love to me, life is a misery. And so she was unhappy with her lover. And she began to look for an alternate lover. And she discovered wealth, money. And she pursued him. And she made love to him. And she had his children. And he began to rule over her and tell her what she could do and what she couldn't do. "Never mind, if you want to do this, if you don't have enough money, you can't. I'll run your life. I'll rule it." And she became captured, a slave of money, and she began to feel cheap. And she discovered another alternate lover. She discovered popularity, fame. And she chased after him. And she had his children. She became popular. But she found that no praise, no recognition was enough to last. It had to come again every day, and she was enslaved to him. And she was getting old. And she went from lover to lover to lover, getting older and uglier and tireder and feeling cheap and knowing herself as a prostitute. And absolutely despondent, in her despair, she lay down and she went to sleep. And during the night, in her sleep, she began to remember. Her thoughts went back. And she had just the faintest memory of this original lover. She began to think of him and describe him. And she jumped up from her sleep and she went out into the city at night, looking and asking the people, "Have you seen such a person? I know that he exists. I have this memory of him. He is so beautiful." She describes his face, his teeth, his hair. He owned cattle on 1,000 hills. He lived in a great mansion. "Have you seen him?" And the people all said, "No, we haven't seen him. Can't imagine someone like that. Never met anyone like that." She went to the watchman at the gates. "Have you seen him?" No one could direct her to this prince, this alternate lover. She went home again, depressed, despondent. And she decided to give up all of the alternate lovers. None of them appealed to her anymore. She didn't care anymore for money or for popularity. Something in her had decided, "None of those things are what will bring me happiness. I want nothing, absolutely nothing, except to return to that original lover." And she said to herself, "If I could find him, I know he wouldn't want me. I wouldn't appeal to him. I'm old and tired and ugly and used and wasted. But if I could find him, maybe I could be a servant, just a maid in his kingdom. I could mop his floors, take care of the cattle in the fields. I'll work for him. I'll try to find him." Exhausted, she fell asleep. She didn't wake up. What woke up was a young girl, a virgin. She woke up suddenly in the middle of the night, having had a dream. a dream that she had been old and ugly and wasted, that she had chased after all these lovers. It was like a nightmare. But as she woke up, there was a light in the corner of the room. It startled her. She sat up and she looked at the light. And it looked like a glowing being, a person. And the person spoke to her and said, "Don't be afraid. I'm not here to harm you. I'm just a messenger. I'm an angel. My name is Gabriel. And I've come to tell you, you're so lucky. You're so fortunate because God is in love with you. He has found you fair and beautiful, wants to make love to you, and wants you to be the mother of his child. Know who you are and make yourself ready to receive him. You'll have a son, and you should call his name God inside me. And as he is born, he will lead you and your people out of bondage and out of captivity. He'll be a new king ruling earth, and he'll change the earth into heaven. He'll be the salvation of you and the people about you." And he said, "Hail Mary, know who you are, what you're here for." And he disappeared. And she became pregnant. She had a child. And people came to see her. Wise people came to see the child and bring him gifts. And shepherds came to see the child and learn from him. And the kings of the earth were jealous of him and tried to kill him. And the people of the earth tried to take what they could from him, of his miracles and his healing and his abundance and his love. But then he became a threat, and they tried to kill him. But he came back more powerful than he had been before and continued to live. And she went to sleep again. And when she woke up, her feet were resting on the earth as her footstool. She was the queen over earth and heaven, wrapped in a robe of light with 12 stars as a crown over her head. And this is the story that goes from the beginning of Genesis to the end of the Revelation, the only story that there is in the Bible. And the most fascinating thing about the story is that you are the main character. You are the bride, the woman, that the divine lover created way back there in the beginning. And you went out into this dazzling earth to experience all of its adventure. And you began to find out that there are alternate lovers. And you've probably been fascinated with a few of them. You've been fascinated with money, with popularity, with sensuality. You've probably made love to some of them and had their children. And it probably made you feel guilty and cheap and unworthy. And you probably had a memory in the back of your mind. You can almost remember that divine lover. And you probably did some wandering through the streets of Jerusalem at night, asking, inquiring, does he really exist? Is this divine lover, is he really there? Does he exist? How can I find him? And some people told you one thing, some people told you another. And you may have become exhausted in your confusion, and you may have lapsed back into your sleep. But the whole purpose of this sharing is tonight, is to say to you, it's time to wake up again. Wake up a virgin. A virgin being someone who has decided all those other lovers are not where it's at. They're not satisfying. They may be entertaining for a time, but they're not satisfying. They're not fulfilling. They won't fill you with the life of the child that is really you, really your life. If you wake up a virgin empty, so that there are no alternate lovers that have any appeal to you, The only lover that you want to make love to is that original lover. If you're a virgin, if you wake up a virgin, then, for the moment at least, I'm Gabriel. And I'm saying to you, Hail Mary, wake up, know who you are. The story is not about somebody who lived a few thousand years ago. The story's about you. You're Mary. It's time to wake up. And maybe the most important thing for you to know is God is absolutely fascinated with you. He's in love with you. Finds you exquisitely beautiful. Wants to make love to you. And wants you to have his child. And if you allow that to happen, if you allow him to plant his love in you so that it grows, then you'll experience having this child living inside you that you will call God in me. And you take care of that child and bring him up. And he'll be born, and when he is born, people will respond in peculiar ways. Wise people will come and bring gifts and lay at his feet. They'll recognize him. Shepherds will come and want to share and want to know and receive his wisdom. People of the earth will want to take advantage of your new life and your new goodness. The kings of the earth, those who have vested interest in controlling you, will try to take his life and stamp him out. So there are both the threats and the beauty, but he, when he grows, will become a ruler over your consciousness, and he will create heaven on earth, and when you wake again, you'll know who you are. The bride of Christ, the queen of heaven, the lover of the original divine lover, and you will have completed your relationship with the source, found your heritage, what you came for, the end of the trip. That's the whole story. It's your story. It's personal.
Straight through the stories
of Genesis and apply some of the ideas that we have from our glossary. We've already worked with the creation part. We've come through the days of creation. And now we want to work with Adam and Eve and their sons. And I want you to keep in mind now that we are talking about the male and female, the father and mother in you, and your sons. So we want to keep this story a personal story about you in your growth. So the father in you is the active part. And you can also, I think, loosely associate this father in you with the left brain, the active logical thinker, the part that reacts to the senses, and the right brain, the intuitive, imaginative, sensitive part of you, you can relate to Eve. And this will give you a feeling for both the positive and the negative counterpart of both of those sides. The left brain or active masculine principle in you is good when it is used in the best way, to make decisions, to take action, to express authority and responsibility. And the right brain, intuitive, imaginative, is the part of you that can receive, can communicate with God, can be sensitive to inspiration, but it also is sensitive to emotion and appetite and feeling and sentimentality, so it can be used in a negative kind of way. And we have examples of both of these inherent in this story. So we're starting out our story of Adam and Eve in the same way that we're going to start our story later in the Gospel of John. Both of them are talking about the beginning of time. Now, the beginning of time that's important to us in spiritual growth is not the history of the planet, but it's the beginning of your time. So what are the challenges that you run into initially in relating to yourself as as a being that can experience growth and can learn to relate to its environment. The challenges that come up to this you, this Adam Eve you, are that there are opportunities to be and remain in harmony, and being and remaining in harmony with your source will mean that, will mean that you live in a Garden of Eden, or that you will live in heaven. As long as you keep your consciousness in balance, in harmony with God, walking and working with God, communicating with God, keeping all things in balance, you will live in a kingdom of heaven. But then when you become attracted to something that is an expression of the appetites, even those things, the fruits that surround you, you can partake of, but not those fruits that will distract you from your purpose. And so this is what the Adam and Eve in you are told. The thing that you must not do is make something else more important than your relationship with your source. Don't put yourself out of balance. Don't partake of those things that are going to distract you from your purpose. You will only recognize good and evil by tasting of evil. And if that becomes something that builds and grows in your mind, I mean, I wonder what that's like. I feel like I'm missing something if I don't have that part of my life, if I don't feel what it feels like to be out of balance or out of sorts. And when we're talking about evil, we're not talking about morality here, as I see it. It may relate to morality, and you can relate it that way if you want. But the thing that is evil is that which is the reverse of life, that which introduces death instead of life. I think it is, it's most interesting to me that the word evil is the word live or live spelled backwards. And that's the best way to understand what evil is. That which takes away from my life and takes me away from the course of life, introduces darkness or death or fear into life. I think that you can relate it to the fact that while we all love beauty and good and balance and joy, there is an element in all of us, or most of us, that is intrigued with fear and danger. And so even in order to be entertained, we must have an element of danger, imbalance, threat, altercation, a problem. One of the things that you're told, if you ever study writing and you ever want to make a short story or a novel or a play or whatever, your teacher will tell you that unless your story contains conflict, it won't be interesting. People won't want to read it. So while we are in love with harmony and balance, we are intrigued with evil and danger. It's the reason that Evel Knievel makes a living doing his foolishness. We're intrigued with the threat of death. And so here are these two parts of your consciousness, and the rational mind can get along and let that temptation stay over there. But this intuitive, imaginative mind begins to think about it. What would it be like? And entertains the thought. And the thought is so entertained that you can almost taste it. And then the rational mind begins to hear from the intuitive mind and begins to put things together rationally. Well, what could it really hurt? And so these parts of your mind get intrigued with this action, and you participate in finding out what imbalance is like. Once you have introduced imbalance into balance, the Garden of Eden is over. The harmony, the beauty, the heaven in your life is gone. And the angels are those powers that bring the beauty and the harmony into your life, but they're the same powers that once you have introduced a conflict in, drive you out of the peace. So what was a protective force becomes a threatening force, and you're driven out of the garden. Now you have two sons. These two sons, again, are a kind of a repeat of what we have just looked at. They are Adam and Eve, again, in Cain and Abel. Cain is the son that goes out to make a living. He's working with the earth. He is the active principle in you, and he's bringing forth a living from the earth, and his thoughts are those rational, logical thoughts. He's the Adam side. And Abel, on the other hand, is the listening, intuitive. He has ordered his mind in such a way that his thoughts always follow after the consciousness of God. His first thought, always, is given to the consciousness of God. So the story speaks of Cain and Abel going to make a sacrifice. Cain brings the fruits of his labor. He brings material result of what he has produced. He brings his vegetables, the things from his garden he gives to God, which is not wrong, but it is not what God is looking for in our growth. It's not what God is looking for from you. Which is not to say you shouldn't make a gift of your material wealth, certainly you should, but only after you have given the first fruits of your thought. The material follows the thought. So what Abel gave was his first thought to God, his sheep. His sheep are his thoughts. That which was brought from the earth by Cain is the material. And what happens then is that the material side of you that has worked and that is rejected is jealous of that other side of you and says, I'm going to do the thinking in this body. You've probably experienced the Cain and Abel experience. In fact, it's something that is taught to us in growing up. While we're growing up, our teachers tell us, use your Cain mind. You're going to have to make a living. And the able mind is always thinking about these things out there, imaginative, intuitive, spiritual. Any one of you who was an artist in grade school was probably told by your teacher, quit drawing those pictures, quit writing those poems, quit doing all of those imaginative things, and get your Cain mind to work. And so our Cain mind is taught to commit murder again. It kills the able mind. It happens to most of us. We kill that side of the mind that is intuitively always giving its first fruits to God because we are taught very effectively by our culture. The most important thing to do is make a living. Follow Cain's pursuit. And so our Cain side kills out the able side. Now he is dead. And now we begin to regret it. We find ourselves feeling punished. Life is hard. And people resent us. We live in a world that is described as dog-eat-dog, and that is the Cain world where Cain is always pursued. He who wears the mark of Cain will always be pursued and always will be killed by those who pursue him, those who follow after him. There's the story of Cain and Abel. It's the story of you and your consciousness. When Abel is killed and Cain goes out to make his fortune, then another child comes and his name is Seth. This next child is a result of experience. And this is the next step in your own spiritual growth. You come to a time where you recognize the value of Abel and you recognize what Cain really is. You recognize his value as well. But you give birth to another son as a result of experience. This next son then is a son of balance. Comes after the disappointment of having lost contact with God, having seen the result of it, having suffered through it. So the next child is the child of bitter experience, and he is born to become a leader. His son then the son of this new child that you've given birth to is one who walks with God. This is Enoch, Methuselah, those who were perfectly attuned to God as a result of these experiences. So this is a step-by-step stages in your own growth and maturity. Then we come to the time of baptism, which is here described as a flood. This is a baptism of the earth. Now remember, the earth is your earth and your life that we're talking about here, and all of these men, women, people are components of your nature. So right now we're not talking about history. We can get into history if you like, and we can talk about the fact that there really was a flood, it really did exist. This is the end of the Atlantean period. It is the end of an age. In fact, if you time the time from Adam to Noah by generations, and if you give 40 years to a generation, you'll find that this is a 2,000-year period. Each 2,000-year period is the movement from one sign of the zodiac to another, or from one age to another age. And this period is the last sign of the zodiac, and this period, beginning after Noah, is the first sign of the zodiac. So this is actually the transition from the third world to the fourth world. If you follow the Hopi four worlds succession, it says that there have been worlds before ours, and they were of a different nature. One was finished, we've come into another one. So these previous worlds went through the entire sequence of the zodiac, through the 12 signs. So that's 12 times 2,000 years, the period of the world preceding this flood. So historically, we're talking about the end of the age of Atlantis, the beginning of the Adamic age, and the beginning of the age of Aries, 2,000 years before the Piscean age began. This is actually the cusp. The age really begins just a little after Noah and just a little before Abraham. But the flood is the transition period from world to world. Now, that's the historical part. In you, this is the part when coming in touch with God, you make a transition through a baptism, this flood. Now, the ark that Noah built, first of all, Noah, the name Noah means rest. Remember what happened on the seventh day in creation. The seventh day was the period of rest, which is the period of coming into harmony with the source, resting in a safe haven. This is the period of coming into balance, harmony, living in heaven again. So we're talking about coming to the seventh period here, from Adam to Noah, is my entire sequence of initiations, coming into right relationship with God. And in the flood, I lose the identity of the old and begin an identity of the new. Now, let me see if I can say that this way. We've just talked about the story of the divine lover. Now that story is told in another way. Instead of saying that this original lover had a bride that he created, the story is told in another way that says this original lover had a son. And this son of his was intrigued with the universe and went out there. This is the prodigal son story. And it says that eventually he realized that where he really belonged was back home with his father. So the prodigal son and the divine lover, the bride, are the same person, told in a different manner, a different allegory, but precisely the same story. When he returns home, there is a party, there is a feast, he is welcomed, and so on. And he becomes the realized son. And that's the key that we're looking for in this story. This is what the flood is all about. It is one thing to become so attuned in our consciousness that we can communicate with God all the time. That's becoming the initiate. But there's a step beyond that in which the identity of myself as human, as man, is so completely lost from my consciousness. I don't identify with that anymore, that the only consciousness that remains is the consciousness of God. Then the person that I was is dead, and the person that I become is alive. And this transition is the crucifixion, or it is the flood. It is the end of an age and the beginning of a new, the final initiation. The word that is used in Hebrew for ark doesn't mean a boat at all. And in fact, it's interesting that it becomes a part of this analogy for a boat sailing over the water, because what the word really means is a haven of rest, a resting place, a comfortable place that's located in a high place where the things of earth wash beneath it. That's what the word really means that is used for the word ark. And the flood is that time when, coming in touch with God, I not only communicate with Him, but I take one more step and I think with His mind. So this is the transition from identification with myself as a human being into identification with God. Or, to say it another way, perhaps more simply, this is becoming Christed. It is to say that while Christians think of Jesus Christ as being the only Son of God, which is actually accurate, there's nothing wrong with that, but the other part of that is to realize that you also are potentially the only Son that God had. Now, how can two of us be the only Son that God had? If the consciousness that is me and my mind is the same consciousness that Christ had, then both of us are that only consciousness. There is only one expression that is the child of God, and that is living love. If I become living love, and no longer me separate from you, but an embodiment of God in this body, then I am the Christ. And nothing else exists within me except the Christ. And this is what Jesus was saying. It is no longer me. I am not me, an individual. I am simply the expression of God in the earth, and God and I are one. And it is not God living in me anymore. It is the God living in me is what I am and who I am, and there is no separation in the identity. When I lose all consciousness of separation, when I no longer think with the mind that is the brain mind, the result mind, but all of my thoughts, all of my guidance, all of my emotions, all of my actions are the expression of God in me, with no other part living in me, then I am one with God. So this flood is that time of coming through those stages of initiation to that final one where I leave the old earth behind. The earth is washed and comes out new after the flood. The flood was 40 days and 40 nights, and we have mentioned before that 40 with a zero, four with a zero, is spirit overcoming matter and creating a new heaven and a new earth. So this is the story or the meaning of the flood. And an interesting thing that you want to notice about Noah is that Noah is a repeat of Adam. So we have a beginning with Adam, and we have a beginning again with Noah. But it's a new beginning, and it's a higher beginning. And notice the components of it. Adam was the father of the race. Noah was the father of the race that followed him. Adam partook of the fruit, and through that fell. Right after the flood, Noah partook of the fruit of the vine, the juice, and fell. Adam had three sons. Noah had three sons. there is the repeat of the story again. We are starting over with a new earth, with a new Adam. But the first Adam was the man of the earth. His name means the red earth coming out of the ground. And the other one has a name that means rest, that which comes on the seventh day. So we have the sixth day man and the seventh day man. The man of the earth and the completed man, the man who knows God. So we're talking about the man beginning and the man ending. Starting a new age with a new consciousness, and this new consciousness is God consciousness. Still made a mistake and fell after having attained that high place. Made the mistake and had to pay for the mistake and build again. So there is the repetition of the story. Both of them came into a beautiful place, fell from it, had to build it again. So once more, the children of his experience build toward the next initiate. And the next initiate that we find is a man named Terah. And Terah is the initiate of Chaldea. We spoke earlier of the Ziggurat temples. I didn't write that up there, and maybe I should, so that you can get the spelling of that. You won't run into it in the Bible, but you may in your Bible studies. The Ziggurat was this Chaldean temple that was built in seven stages. Each stage representing one of these stars or planets, and the temple itself being an astrological chart in stone built by a master builder who was an initiate of symbology, of geometry, of astrology, of dream interpretation, was a wise man who was advisor to a king, and who was the supreme authority, I think you could say, on the Chaldean religion. And you have to recognize here that the Chaldean religion was a religion based on the moon. Now, as we study ancient religions from our prejudice perspective, we can fall into the trap of thinking of ourselves as very evolved people. I mean, we worship God. I mean, the real God. And here are all these primitive religions that worship the moon, the sun, the animals, nature, and so on. And from an ego perspective, we can think of those as lesser religions. And I think we do ourselves a disservice by that. If you really look at the cosmology of ancient Egypt or ancient Chaldea, what you're going to really find is not that they worshiped the moon at all, but rather that they recognize the moon as an expression of God that has a particular effect on the affairs of men. And they no more worshiped the moon than we worship the trappings of religion in our society. We don't worship the Bible, but we use it as an instrument for understanding God. They didn't worship the moon, but they used it as an instrument for understanding its source. And the Chaldeans were amazing people. They knew about aspects of astronomy that they couldn't possibly have known, scientists say, without powerful telescopes. We haven't found any evidence that they had the powerful telescopes, but they knew what they would have found out by looking through telescopes, but apparently they found out about it some other way. Maybe they did have telescopes. Maybe they were powerful. Maybe they studied astronomy over centuries, or maybe they had a fantastic teacher who taught them these things, and maybe he knew some other way. We don't know, but what we do know is that they could predict the placement of the stars over centuries of time, and they did so and wrote it in stone. They accomplished things that we would find difficult to accomplish today. So they were a very accomplished race. As a matter of fact, we're talking about 3000 BC now, 5000 years ago, And until recently, it was believed that that was a very primitive period. But what has more recently been discovered is that the city where Terah lived in the Middle East, a place called Ur of the Chaldees, was a fascinating city that had very elaborate homes with indoor plumbing, running water inside. That's fairly amazing if you look at the Middle East today. In the area where the city was located, the homes are considerably less complex than the homes at the time that this man lived there. So we're talking about a highly educated, sophisticated culture that had technology way before its assigned period in time and had international communications. The people of Chaldea communicated with the people of Egypt and the people of the Far East. They were in communication with China, with Japan, with India, and shared ideas. And their initiates had an interesting network of communication of ideas and thoughts. There was a great library in Egypt, and they shared the wisdom of their initiates with the wisdom of the Egyptian initiates. And one of the things that would happen is that when an initiate took an apprentice, which was very often his son, he would send that apprentice to the mystery schools of the other nations to carry his knowledge, his secrets further. These gifts of wisdom, these occult understandings, the understandings of universal law, were the very highest premium in the culture of that time. These were powerful people who possessed these secrets. And so it was a very precious thing, shared only with a very few. So the son of Terah, as the son of the most powerful man, perhaps in Chaldea, had entree to the wisdom schools of the pharaohs in Egypt and was sent there to study. He was given a name, this son. His name was Abba or Abbas, a Chaldean name which meant father. The significance of that name being that he would give birth to the next generation of thought in Chaldea. He was the inheritor of the initiate's wisdom. He was sent to Egypt to study the initiatory wisdom there and studied that, and another syllable was added to his name. And the syllable there was a syllable relating to the god of Egypt, Ra or Ram, so that his name became Abram. And now with this wisdom of initiation from the school of the moon in Chaldea and the school of the sun in Egypt, he had this awareness that the moon affects emotions, the flow of the tides, the ebb and flow of liquids within the body, the affairs of men, consciousness. He recognized that the moon is a powerful force in the universe. In Egypt, he discovered that the sun is a powerful force in the universe. And according to the story, he came between them, halfway between Egypt and Chaldea. Now we're not speaking historically. We're talking about you and me. We discover that there are powerful elements in our life, material elements, the sun and the moon. Take that not so literally, but to say that the physical things of our life that influence us one way or another are powerful. They are powerful gods, the material gods of the earth. But there comes a time when we stop between those two material gods, we come to a desert place. Remember the desert? That's when I have all these ideas, I have all these opinions, I have all this knowledge. The best thing that can happen to a person who has a lot of knowledge is to come to a desert place where you suddenly feel as if you know absolutely nothing. That's what coming to the desert is. It's another way of saying he became virgin. He dropped his preferences, he dropped his ideas. In spite of the fact that he was a master builder, an initiate of geometry, mysticism, occult law, all of these things, he came to a point where he realized, with all that I know, with all the people who are in awe of what I know is really nothing. And in this desert place, he cried out. He cried out to say, sure, the sun is powerful, the moon is powerful, I can see its effect on the affairs of men, but there has to be a force that set the sun and moon in motion, and it is that that I want to know. And that opening, without opinion, without prejudice, opened him to the next step in realization. And according to the story, there came walking to him across the desert a man who introduced himself, saying that he was the Prince of Peace. His name was Melchizedek, and he identified himself as the ruler of a city, a king of a city called Peace. And he said, don't get the idea that that's a particular place around here, or that that I am a person caught in space and time, as you are. He said instead that he was without beginning or ending of days. He had always been and always will be an eternal being who is the Prince of Peace. Wonder who that is. So this child of God, son of God, this Christ, came into his desert to teach him. And the first thing that he did was a little ritual, interesting little ritual. He served him some wine and some bread. They had communion. He gave him the power, which is the wine, and the substance, which is the bread, of understanding. And in his understanding, he explained to him some secrets of enlightenment. One of those secrets had to do with the laws of prosperity in relation to God, and he instituted the law of tithing. He said the secret of prosperity is that if you are so anxious about material things that you have to hold on to them, and you save them, and you make sure that they serve you, then your anxiety about them introduces fear into your relationship with them, and they're stopped. They cannot grow. If, on the other hand, the first portion, or as he said it, the first tenth of everything that you receive, you give immediately back to God, then your giving has said, I am so secure in what I have that I don't have to be anxious about it. I know myself to be wealthy and provided for. However limited my funds, I will give the first tenth of them to go out. And this expression of security says, my security is not in my money or what I hold, but in the source of prosperity. And this will open the flow of prosperity. So he began this principle of tithing, and he gave a tenth of all that he had to this man, Melchizedek. And then he continued through his life, giving away a tenth of everything he had to whoever happened to be handy to give that to, usually to someone who had in some way influenced him or worked with him in his life. And the other principle that he was given was a principle of circumcision. And I hope this is not uncomfortable for you to talk about, because there are two things that people get uncomfortable with in New Age conversations. That's sex and money, and here I'm talking about both of them. But in this second one, this ritual of circumcision, the teaching was essentially this, that there is in the creation of man, there's a source of energy. This source of energy is the life force in man. This life force is ours to invest in whatever we are attracted to. If what we are attracted to is the pleasure of the flesh or sensuality and security and the expression of emotion in relationships, then those levels of expression will consume that energy or that life force. If, however, we go beyond those three expressions to a fourth expression, the fourth expression being the absence of fear, which allows unconditional love. That absence of fear will allow that life force to be expressed in a perfect expression of love, of unconditional love, and we will have lifted our consciousness to that fourth level. And if, with this absence of fear, we go a step further, having no separation between the individual will and the will of the source, then this lack of separation between the wills will open the center of the will and lift our consciousness to its fifth higher expression. And if, with this absence of fear, and our investment not in sensuality, emotion in relationships, insecurity, and the fear areas, we have given it to unconditional love, our will being one with the source, then we'll begin to see in a different way. We'll see with a different perspective. We will see not just with our eyes, but with the eyes of understanding, and the sixth level will be opened. And if in seeing, we become not fascinated with power or with separation, but want only to be one with the source, then that seventh level will open, our consciousness will open, and the separation between self, the lower, the animal, and God, the source, will be ended, and we experience the Christ in us, becoming one with the Christ. And in demonstration of this principle, Melchizedek said to Abraham, now the most obvious expression of this energy or this power is your sexuality. When you express sexual energy, you are taking this life force and you are expressing it physically. And when you express emotion, insecurity, fear-related things, it is of these three lower levels, which in the Kabbalistic tree that we will get to a little bit later, will be the lower trinity of the tree, a lower trinity and a higher trinity, the lower trinity being the lower three chakra levels, if we can introduce that word, or the three lower levels of the expression of the life force. So he said to him, if instead of investing your energy in the relationships of appetites and sensuality and insecurity, you will commit this energy to its highest purpose. Then the energy will rise through you to reform your consciousness, and the power that is in it, instead of going into powerful expressions of emotions and physical experiences, that power will now be invested in the higher trinity in you and will transform your consciousness. And so in order to express that commitment, he took away the sensitivity of the instrument for expression in the physical, which is to say the rite of circumcision was the removal of the foreskin over the gland at the end of the penis, which would desensitize that organ, taking away the direction toward pleasure, making it only slightly less pleasurable experience, but the symbolic value of it was to say, I give up this most physical expression to say to the energy involved, I want you to reverse yourself and go to a new and higher purpose. I want the power of my reproduction to reproduce in me spiritual children rather than children of the flesh. And the teaching was not to suggest that sexuality was wrong. It was to suggest that the energy that is expressed in sexuality, appetites, emotion, emotional bond relationships, love that is based on selfishness, manipulation, holding and clutching people, owning them, that kind of expression of love or appetite could be turned into a higher expression that is more productive, and there can be a balance in life. Not that appetites are to be rejected altogether, but they do not become the god. In fact, that lesson was followed with one more lesson that made it perhaps a little clearer. And that other lesson is called the Abrahamic sacrifice. And it may be one of the most difficult of the lessons to understand, but at the same time, it is the single most important one, because this Abrahamic initiation is the one that allows the person that complete experience of relationship with God. And this lesson said, the only way to have the perfect relationship with God is to want that more than you want anything else. Now, it's easy to say, I want that more than I want anything else, until you begin to question what that anything else might be. Your money, oh, well, I could give that up for a perfect relationship with God. Your home, well, yes, that's not that difficult, too. Your children, and we begin to realize that there are things that we really love, and if we have to make a choice here, the choice seems very unfair. But the secret of coming to the right choice might be expressed like this. As a parent, I might feel an anxiety about what can happen with children. The very best parent, the most loving, the most highly trained parent, one who has studied all of the wonderful techniques of parenting and relating to children, all the best psychology, and all of the best things that you can do as a parent, do not guarantee that your child is not going to fall prey to some terrible illness or get in trouble or turn out in some way that you hadn't planned for. There is a limit to the quality of control or protectiveness that we can express on our children. If I make the mistake of saying, this is my child, and I won't release this child, I don't want to have to make that decision, I want to give this up for God, then I have said, I make this child mine, and I take responsibility for his safety. And if I stop and think, it's not really something that I can do. If, on the other hand, I release this child with the realization, God loves the child as much as I do, at least, and is far more capable of bringing up this child than I am, far more capable of guaranteeing the safety and seeing after the steps and the growth of this child, if I can sacrifice this child to God, in the sense of saying, this is not my child any longer, belongs to God. If God wants to take the life of this child so that the child goes to be with him, I've already released him to God as God's child, not mine. I have only custody, protective custody, to take care of God's child and do what I can. But I've released this to the source. And my first love is the source, not the child. I've made a choice. I have committed myself so much to the source that all that I have, my mind, my talents, my money, my children, my family, my friends, my reputation, everything that I might consider important is now released to that source, and I make that first in my life. This is what the Abrahamic sacrifice was all about. And that is the final lesson that Melchizedek gave to Abraham, to say to him, first of all, you couldn't even have a child as you wanted. His wife couldn't get pregnant. And all of the machinations that he went through to make sure that he had a son and heir didn't quite work. But God gave him a child when he couldn't have one otherwise, when his wife was 90 years old and when he was well past the age where those things are likely to be possible. He had a son. The son became precious to him, but according to his teacher, the son became too precious. And when he began to make that more important in his life than the source, then God pointed out to him, your child has become your God. That has become what you give your time, your attention, your worship. And it's dangerous. It's dangerous when anything takes the place of God in your life. And maybe another way of saying that is, if there is anything in your life that if it were taken away would destroy your happiness, you have a wrong relationship with it. And the job of your teacher, your inner teacher, the job of your teacher is to change that relationship, which means that you have put yourself in an extremely vulnerable position, and the single most likely thing for you to lose is that thing that you least want to lose. Not a good position to put yourself in. And this is the position that Abraham had put himself in with his son. What was his son? Maybe we're talking about a child physically. Maybe we're talking about something else. For me, the Abrahamic sacrifice involved the fellowship. That was my son, and that was what I was asked to give up. And it was a painful experience, an interesting experience. Frightening, painful, feeling that you are losing your child and you're watching it happen. Your son, what you have given birth to, what is competing for your love and your interest with God, what is it? If you can find that thing, whatever it is, immediately put it in different perspective. Putting it in different perspective may mean getting rid of it, and it may not. It may only mean putting it into such a relationship with you that you look at it and say, yes, I can give that up. If it's wiped out tomorrow and I don't have it, I still will have a right relationship with God and joy in my life, no matter what it is. What is it for you? What would be the instrument that would be used by your teacher to allow you to go through this initiation of the Abrahamic sacrifice? I suggest that you find it. Whatever it is that you want most in the world, whatever you want so much that if God said, give that up or lose your relationship with me, you would hesitate. Whatever that is, give it up quick. Give it to God. Give it up in such a way that you have said to God, if I lose it tomorrow, I'll still be all right, won't be angry, hurt, bitter, blaming you. I will still have a right relationship. It will not destroy my joy. It does not have that capacity anymore. When it doesn't have that wrong relationship, then you are no longer in danger of losing it. Your teacher doesn't need to take it away if it wouldn't be meaningful to you anyway if he did take it away. Put it in that perspective, and you're much safer with it than trying to hang on to it and try to keep from losing it. It's stated that way a couple of times. Whoever would cling to his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. And so it is with whatever you are making the joy of life contingent on. That's the Abrahamic sacrifice. So this circumcision ritual was the commitment of the energy of life, the vitality of life, to a higher purpose, and making a choice between the expression of the appetites, emotions, relationships,